Tomatoes Market Fresh, helping perfect your California flavor.
You're listening to the Eat, Drink, Explore Radio Network.
Fabulous.
Live every Sunday with the very latest food, beverage, and travel trends.
Amazing.
Now here's the host of our show, Mr. Randall White.
Good Sunday, Funday morning, everyone. You have arrived at California's number one place to talk about current trends in food, beverages, travel, and tourism. It is our goal to give you the tools you need to enjoy life's pleasures in a healthy, sustainable, and community-focused manner. I'm joined each and every week here at the Eat, Drink, Explore Media desk by my cohort for many, many years, Miss Patty Pyburn.
Good morning, everyone.
Yeah, good morning, Patty. So both of us down in some tea this morning to get started. I've only had my first sip or two.
Mine's too hot to drink still.
It's too hot. Yeah, it's the Republic of Tea. We had them on the show, six months ago mm-hmm. or so, out of Novato, California. And it's delicious. They sent us some samples, and
we're still working on it. I'm drinking the Japanese tea this morning.
The umachi.
It has some citrus. And it has citrus in it. So I thought that might help. Because woo, did I wake up with a case of allergies this morning?
Everyone, those winds.
The wind.
Really, yeah, and it's going to be windy again today.
And so I'm so tired of the hot weather. I opened all the windows in the house. So just probably blew in whatever I could be allergic to. Blew in overnight.
That's the problem. All right, straight ahead on this hour of the program. When is the last time you checked the ingredients on a bottle of wine, Patty?
Oh,
ever?
Never.
Yeah, right. Well, they're not typically listed.
The way I check the ingredients is I look to see how much is left in the bottle.
Right. Well, it might tell you like the percentage of grapes used sometimes.
Or the alcohol content.
The alcohol content. Mm-hmm. But the actual ingredients aren't listed because wine is one of those products that if it's called wine, it has a certain set mm-hmm. list of ingredients. But there actually are some. If you do list the ingredients, if you actually put ingredients, colon, and then start, and you put right. wine grapes, you need to list every single thing that went into making
everything.
You can't just mm-hmm. put one. If you're going to list them, you got to list them all. That's the rules.
Okay.
Well, there's a winery in the Santa Cruz Mountains. Actually, I don't know if technically that's the Santa Cruz Mountains or not. It's a Cupertino area, Ridge Winery, that is now listing the ingredients because they feel everyone should know exactly what's in their wine. And so they're listing it. We'll talk to them about the whys and what some of these ingredients are. Because I'll tell you right now, your bottle of wine likely has more than just...
It does have more than wine grapes.
Yes. Right?
So yes.
That should be a very interesting segment. And let's see, what else do we have here? Our travel deals segment includes mm-hmm. Gabe Saglia with Travel Zoo, who has some Cinco de Mayo flavored destinations and others.
Very nice.
He included a couple of Mexico stops that, just for fun today.
Yeah.
We'll also talk about how the number of adults in the U.S. that actually exercise like they're supposed to.
Oh, you think some people aren't exercising?
Well, it's funny because the how people respond to their activity levels
right
in their head,
right,
they think they exercise a lot more than,
if only the couch could talk.
Exactly. The next hour, we will speak to a man who has taken on Caltrans. I just love this story. I can't wait to talk to him. He's taken on Caltrans to get the word out mm-hmm. to slow motorists. You know those windy roads? We have a lot of them in mm-hmm. coastal California, yeah. up in the foothills.
They're beautiful
like that,
and scenic.
Right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But did you know that let's say you're at the front of a long line of cars and you're going slow because you don't know the roads and you're scared, you know.
That'd be me.
That would be you. If you have five or more cars behind you, it is the law that you have to pull over.
You're supposed to pull over.
But if you've ever driven stretches of highway,
where would you pull over?
Well, they have turnouts every so often.
Yeah.
People don't use them. And mm-hmm. I've been one of those that screams at the top of my lung, why didn't you just pull over? You know, you have five or more cars behind you. You know, a lot of people just, that's kind of an obscure rule that people don't
right.
really know that one.
It isn't commonly known. Yeah. I didn't know the number of cars. I just knew if you were slowing traffic that you should yield to them and let them pass you. But just, so five. Okay.
Yeah, just out of sheer politeness.
You can, yeah. you can hold up four people.
You can hold up four as long as you like.
But not five.
Not five. So anyway, this guy, he lives in Muir Beach, which is by Stinson Beach, north of San Francisco. And he decided, after years of battling Caltrans, and they kept saying, oh yeah, the signs are on the way, and the signs never showed up.
Right.
He made his own. And he started putting them up on Highway 1. And Caltrans said, okay.
Wait, hold on a minute.
Hold on a minute. You can't do that. Even though everything on the sign was accurate, and he made some pretty nice looking signs. So anyway, we'll chat with him about that.
That is interesting.
And then also, we'll talk about the art of making cookies that are healthy. Stealthy healthy, they're called. Patty, you did this as a segment on your television show.
On Central Coast News.
On
yes, I did.
Television show
on
thingy
that TV
you do.
Show that I do every morning.
Every morning, exactly. So anyway, those are some of the topics that we have coming up. And I
yeah, those cookies, I can't. Have you tasted them yet?
I did. Anthony brought some in for our Thursday night show that we have here
locally. Right.
And they were delicious.
It's very nice for people who have some, you know, are making different diet choices or diet restrictions for medical reasons. It's nice to have an option, isn't it?
It is. And I just love the whole stealthy healthy. So, and they'll give us some pointers. Patty, thank you for pointing them out to us.
Sure.
But right now it is time for the top headlines of the day. And for that, we turn it over to Patty Pyburn.
Indeed. It's all the brain power I can muster to get that song to play. All right. From the Eat, Drink, Explore news desk on this Sunday morning, Bay Area sports fans are in the middle of an amazing streak that even non-sports fans can appreciate. Tonight, the San Jose Sharks host Vancouver for Game 3 of their best-of-7 Stanley Cup playoff series, with the Sharks already winning the first two. The Golden State Warriors are heading to San Antonio tomorrow night as the team is moving to the next round of the NBA playoffs.
Yeah, that's going to be a tough one for them. But we'll see.
But they're in it.
This is the first time I can remember them getting that far in my lifetime.
Yeah. I mean, if someone could prove us wrong, but I can't think of another time either.
Right.
Okay, so the team is moving to the next round, beating the Denver Nuggets Thursday. San Francisco Giants will be playing the LA Dodgers. Love that, because I am a fan of baseball.
Yes, me too. Oh, I went to bed last night. The game was tied, but I just had to get to sleep.
Well, that's tonight at AT&T Park. This is Game 3 of the series. The Giants winning the first two. Last night, Gilroy's Robert Guerrero lost to Floyd Mayweather for the welterweight title fight in Las Vegas. Wow.
It's been nonstop, and just so much excitement Bay Area-wise. And then a friend of mine also, I haven't researched this, but a friend of mine said that now it looks like the 49ers will host Super Bowl 50, and I guess that's 2016 when they build that new stadium down in Santa Clara. And so it was announced that they pretty much have a lock on it, that the Super Bowl's coming to town also. So the Bay Area is just like, you know, and that comes on the heels of a Super Bowl and a World Series. So.
Right. Big time.
Yeah.
I love it. Very exciting. Hey, so we've seen a dramatic change in the weather, although the winds haven't really died down. It's just not the hot, dry. It was still windy, at least here in San Luis Obispo.
It is going to be windy up and down the coast, as a matter of fact. We'll get to the weather, Patty, and your next couple of stories, because we were long-winded. Is that the...
Yeah, we were long-winded. Yeah. I think you were long-winded, but whatever.
Anthony liked that. Call me out, Patty. But no, that's okay. So we will get to the rest of the news and the forecast, which, boy, way different than what we had last week. That's all coming up here in just a moment on Eat, Drink, Explore Radio. We'll also talk about how much you exercise or don't, as the case may be. Randall White here, host of Eat, Drink, Explore Radio, with a tip for Central Coast wine tasting. Eberle Winery was recently voted Winery of the Year by the world's top sommeliers and has one of the best local tours according to Wine Spectator. Eberle Winery opened daily 10 to 6, and the winery's cave tours and wine tasting always complimentary. It's easy to find, too. Located on Highway 46 East, just 3.5 miles from Highway 101. Now it's time to plan your visit. Just head to eberlewinery.com.
Seems everybody's going organic, including lawn care. Did you know communities across the country are converting their lawns, playgrounds, and playing fields to an organic care program? And it's working. You can safely control weeds and pests and have a beautiful lawn. Your kids, pets, and water supplies will be safer, and your neighbors will be green with envy. Oh, and in the long run, organic lawn care is cheaper than doing it the conventional way. Switch to organic lawn care today. Visit pesticidefreelawns.org. The folks who brought you this public service message. Check out pesticidefreelawns.org today.
California business owners, entrepreneurs, farmers, authors, and other professionals, this message is for you. We're looking to highlight those of you who give back to the community, care about the environment, and have the health of our state as part of your business model or focus. Our new California Love website is in the beta testing phase. So, during the next few months, we're offering free listings to qualified people or business entities. It's a win-win situation. You help populate our site with quality, locally owned California companies, and we help direct customers to your business or product. Simply head over to caluv.com. That's C-A as in California, L-U-V as in a cute way to spell love.com, and enter the information for your business today. Why wouldn't you? It's easy and it's free. caluv.com, the California Love business recommendation tool.
The Eat, Drink, Explore Media radio show you are currently enjoying is in a local affiliate commercial break. Live programming will return shortly. Did you know you can watch a live video simulcast of our Sunday morning and Thursday evening shows from your computer, smartphone, or tablet device? And to top it off, it's free. Simply head to eatdrinkexplore.com or download our free app from the Google Play or Apple App Store. If you have a suggestion for an upcoming guest segment, send an email to radio@eatdrinkexplore.com. We're always looking for fresh ideas, including yours. We love to share fresh, local, organic, seasonal, and sustainable ideas throughout the week. And the best place to find those are on our Twitter, YouTube, and Facebook feeds. Our username across the social networking universe is simple: Eat, Drink, Explore, all one word. Hey, college students, Eat, Drink, Explore Media is always looking for qualified journalism or marketing interns. Send us an email today so we can check your status and put you on the list for upcoming intern vacancies. Would you like to hear this Eat, Drink, Explore radio program on one of your local radio stations? Let the station know and contact us as well so we can get the ball rolling. Okay, you made it. The local affiliate commercial break is now over. Time for more informative and entertaining programming from Eat, Drink, Explore Media. Thank you for your patience. And a very good morning, everyone. 8:19, now the time here on this Sunday.
And hello, hello, hello. Thank you for joining us today here on the Eat, Drink, Explore radio network. I am your host,
what is
Randall White,
here?
And it is time now for our popular health
Randall's
and fitness segment where we speak with experts on the topics of
in just a
diet, nutrition, and the variety of other means you...
Okay.
There we go. Okay.
So...
The ghost in the machine is back again.
I am telling you this. I went through every single segment last week to pull.
And they just keep coming back.
All of that audio. I really apologize. I don't know where, I don't know how that's popping back in there.
Right.
But,
but it is.
But
it's
it
there.
Is. I need to take the computer home with me and just give it a bath.
Right. Exactly. Clean it up.
Just clean it up. Exactly.
Either that or try that, you know, old method of just kicking it.
Oh, yeah. Hit it over on the top and give it a kick on the old tower.
Adjust the rabbit ears if you need to.
Exactly. Okay, so, Patty, it is 20 minutes now past the hour.
It is.
And we interrupted your news report, and I believe you were getting to the fires.
I was. I was just commenting on the fact that it is gray. It's overcast. It's cooler. Mm-hmm. I think this is affecting a lot of the coastal section of California. But those winds haven't let up, I think, like the firefighters would like to see. Yeah. But this weekend's cooler marine-influenced weather is helping firefighters. They are making some progress on those fires. Okay. Now, last week's hot, windy conditions helped spread more than a dozen wildfires. And right as Cal Fire came out and announced that they were starting what they call peak fire season for California, because we're never really out of fire season here in California. No. It's always a concern. Fires just erupted across the state. So the largest has burned about 28,000 acres. This is in Ventura County. Mm-hmm. They're still working on it, but it's called the Springs Fire. It is 60% contained this morning. This is from an alert that was just sent out by Cal Fire across the state. So
yeah, that's up a bit from overnight.
Yeah, they've made some progress. Mm-hmm. No word yet on a cause. Those evacuations, though, for thousands of people, including there's a college that was evacuated there, that's lifted. So that's good news. The Panther Fire, that's burned about 7,000 acres so far near Lawson National Park. That is at 40% containment this morning. And this has really started out this fire season, which they were predicting. Well, they know it's going to be longer because it started earlier. So hence, you know, it will be longer. But they really were predicting that it would be more active than what we've seen.
I saw a report by KPCC down in Southern California that said Cal Fire has already burned through 3/4 of their emergency fund mm-hmm. for the year.
Right. They have 4,000 firefighters currently right now, even with the progress that they've made on what they call the front lines of these fires. So more than 4,000 firefighters working this morning.
Wow. Yeah. That Panther up by Lassen National Park.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So Springs Fire, that threatened thousands of acres of prime ag land in Ventura County. When you drive through there, you see all those fields, strawberry, spinach, radish fields. Well, a report in the ag industry online newspaper, The Packer, says only a small fraction of those crops were affected.
That's good.
But the big concern, of course, was the farm workers. They had to be taken out of the fields as the air quality was really bad. We saw those alerts for the whole area.
Yeah.
And, of course, the very hot temperatures into the 90s with very low humidity. So mm-hmm. not good conditions to be outside working for anyone.
No. Mm-mm.
So, Randall.
Yes.
Happy Cinco de Mayo.
Yes. Happy Cinco de Mayo.
Happy National Chocolate Custard and National Hoagie Day as well.
A hoagie is a sandwich, right? That's mm-hmm. on a big bun.
Yeah, I think of it like a big sub sandwich, but...
Yeah, right. Uh-huh. Yeah, I think we call them subs out here in
In our neck of the woods.
Right. So, no matter what your flavor is today, you're covered.
Yeah, you can go with the cold cuts and cheese. Yeah. Custard, eat up.
Right.
For all those chocolate lovers. Or dig into some Mexican food for Cinco de Mayo. Or just all of it if you want to.
And we're having a little Cinco de Mayo festival at our
Fiesta
at your house today.
Indeed we are. I'm going to grill some shrimp and some other assorted vegetables for you.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. Yes.
I was going to say maybe bring your own tofu, though. I don't have any of
that. I'll bring some tepe.
Hey, Randall, should we talk about the weather?
Yes.
Because it's a changing. Mm-hmm. It's, of course, just look outside. It's gray, it's cloudy, it's windy for a lot of the coastal section of the state. Can you believe that there's a chance for some thunderstorms, isolated thunderstorms? And this goes all the way north, even down to Los Angeles over the next couple of days.
Thank goodness it's going to be cooler and wet because dry lightning is a big no-no here in California.
The rain's going to help. The thunderstorms, not so much. We don't want lightning.
No.
But at least it is accompanied by cooler weather. Mm. The wind is still a factor. If you look at the weather maps from the National Weather Service, it's like a rainbow. We have, for anyone going out in the water, which is probably not wise if you're just going out for recreation, small craft advisory, gale force winds, wind advisory.
Yikes.
Just about every kind of thing you can think about along the coast of California, we have it.
I think I saw in San Luis Obispo the gusts could be up to 36 miles mm-hmm. an hour.
Yes, exactly. So we have, a very colorful weather map this morning with all these special weather conditions. So going to be some interesting weather over the next couple of days.
Yeah, not as bad in the Central Valley today.
A little tamer.
I think I saw Sacramento might be in the upper 70s or even 80 mm-hmm. degrees with some sunshine, but that'll change. They're going to have a cool week, which I know my parents welcome. They're not big fans of it. Okay, before we run out of time for this segment, we need to talk about this report this past week by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention in Hotlanta. They say the fact of the matter is, when it comes to a combination of strength training and aerobic exercise, only 1 in 5 adults
meet the overall guidelines set forth by the federal government.
I can't believe it.
Well, you know, at first I was like, oh, well, thank goodness I'm in that one in five. And then I realized I'm not in the
maybe
one in
not.
Five.
What are you not doing?
I'm not doing the strength training.
Oh.
I do plenty of aerobic exercise.
Yeah, I think I'm definitely failing in the strength training area myself.
Yeah, I don't lift any weights. Mm-hmm. You know, about a year ago, I was lap swimming every day, and I started, you know, feeling like my upper body was getting stronger. Mm-hmm. So I thought, when I get home from lap swimming, I'm going to do a few push-ups. And that'll be, because that's what the recommendations are for, that you need to do some level of mm-hmm. push-ups, sit-ups, or activities using resistance bands or weights. That's
okay.
What
the So it could be lifting your own body weight then.
Yeah. Uh-huh. And so I thought, well, I'm going to do these push-ups. I did 3 push-ups and pulled something in my shoulder.
Oh, I remember that.
And I'm like, oh, I am in my late 40s after all. And that was, I was like, I'm not doing any more push-ups because I didn't realize.
That hurts.
It was smart, as they once said.
Yeah.
So anyway, people need to get on it. Let's see. The physical, as far as the physical, the aerobic amount that the federal government recommends, and mm-hmm. so think to yourself at home as you're listening to this or in your car, do you get at least 2.5 hours cumulative of per week of moderate to intensive aerobic activity, walking, jogging, bike riding, hiking, whatever it might be, and 15 minutes, let's see, and 15 minutes a week of vigorous. Okay. So at least 15 minutes needs
to
be vigorous.
So moderate to intense for 2.5 hours a week, and then an hour and 15 minutes a week of vigorous intense.
Oh, yeah,
is that right?
Hour and 15 minutes, yeah.
Yikes. So that totals 3 hours and 45 of a combination of moderate to intense to vigorous to intense.
Yeah. That's
wow.
That's more than I thought. I think a lot of people now realize that it's more than they thought. Because
I am not getting there every week. But this is where you can opt to take the stairs instead of the elevator and kind of work some of that into your daily routine.
Park a little farther away at the grocery store.
And then run to the store.
And then run. Right. Run to the store. The air-conditioned store. So Colorado, apparently, is the healthiest of the states. They always fall.
Because they're all outdoors being healthy and
I used to live in
life.
Boulder. And I can tell you, everyone's
Were you
really
healthier then?
Well, I was in my early 20s.
So you were healthier then. Okay.
I hiked every moment I could, or skied if it was wintertime. Mm-hmm. But yeah, the highest percentage, 27% in Colorado there, that meet these guidelines. The lowest, I don't know if this comes as a surprise or not, Tennessee and West Virginia at 13%. It's always kind of in that South Appalachian range.
Where it drops off.
Where it drops off significantly, it seems like to me. And but the West in general, and that includes California here, had the highest percentage of people that did meet these guidelines.
So. Well, when you think about the weather and the conditions outdoors, it sort of correlates, I feel like, with some of those numbers.
You're right. All right, stick around, everyone. In just a moment, we're back speaking wine ingredients.
Can we have your attention for a moment? Eat, Drink, Explore Media has an important date we want to share with you. Saturday, July 13th. We invite you to join us at a craft beer and food event like no other. At Last Count, generous samples from more than 70 breweries will be paired with local culinary treats for the 2013 Breast Fest along San Francisco's waterfront at Fort Mason. Going on its 14th year, the annual Breast Fest has grown dramatically, raising money for an incredibly important cause, providing free complimentary treatments for women battling breast cancer. The Charlotte Maxwell Clinic offers services such as acupuncture, massage, organic foods, and transportation. The clinic's core mission to provide relief from the terrible side effects of cancer and its treatments. Eat, Drink, Explore Media is very proud to be among the main sponsors for this year's event. For more information, go to thebreastfest.org.
The traditional light bulb, a groundbreaking invention in 1879. Other groundbreaking ideas from that time, the whalebone corset, the pedal-operated submarine, and the two-story outhouse. We've come a long way since then. It's time our light bulbs did the same. Visit EnergySavers.gov and learn about energy-saving light bulbs. See, these new bulbs are more efficient than the old ones, like a text message is more efficient than a carrier pigeon. They last longer, too. Like how we humans last longer now that doctors use antibiotics instead of leeches. And they cut down on our energy costs. Because in our own groundbreaking age of aeroplanes and moving pictures, we deserve a light bulb that saves us some cash. Saving energy saves you money. Learn more at energysavers.gov. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Energy and the Ad Council.
The Eat, Drink, Explore Media radio show you are currently enjoying is in a local affiliate commercial break. Live programming will return shortly. Did you know you can watch a live video simulcast of our Sunday morning and Thursday evening shows from your computer, smartphone, or tablet device? And to top it off, it's free. Simply head to eatdrinkexplore.com or download our free app from the Google Play or Apple App Store. If you have a suggestion for an upcoming guest segment, send an email to radio@eatdrinkexplore.com. We're always looking for fresh ideas, including yours. We love to share fresh, local, organic, seasonal, and sustainable ideas throughout the week. And the best place to find those are on our Twitter, YouTube, and Facebook feeds. Our username across the social networking universe is simple. Eat, Drink, Explore, all one word. Hey, college students, Eat, Drink, Explore Media is always looking for qualified journalism or marketing interns. Send us an email today so we can check your status and put you on the list for upcoming intern vacancies. Would you like to hear this Eat, Drink, Explore radio program on one of your local radio stations? Let the station know and contact us as well so we can get the ball rolling. Okay, you made it. The local affiliate commercial break is now over. Time for more informative and entertaining programming from Eat, Drink, Explore Media. Thank you for your patience.
And a very good morning, everyone. 8:33 now the time here on this Sunday fun day, Cinco de Mayo. I should have programmed some music that would be festive.
Yeah,
you
some
know.
Fiesta music.
Right, but I did not. So you'll just have to get into the groove of it on your own.
I thought maybe we'd have some mariachis in here.
Well, yeah. You know, they're expensive. They're not cheap. My in-laws hire them for different events. It has to be a big event, you know, like a wedding or something.
Right.
And but you know, you pay per band member. So when you see like those for a real good mariachi band, it needs to be at least like what, Ricardo, would you say like 10 people or so in the band?
You can get 10 or
Yeah, so when you start calculating that out,
it adds up.
And if they're there for the whole event, that's pricey. So, yeah, no mariachi. Sorry, Patty.
Darn it.
I know. Okay, as we were talking off the top of the show this morning, when was the last time you looked at a wine label? You know, most people look at the wine label to find out where it's from, what appellation, and is it a California wine? And,
right.
And then, of course, the type. Is it a Syrah? Is it a Zinfandel?
I always like to see if they're cute or clever, the wine, the label.
Well, let me tell you what, Patty, as far as wine marketing goes, they're targeting you right now. Some of the top wines right now are targeted specifically to women that want that.
The creative, cute, clever, appealing labels.
Yeah.
Very nice.
What you don't often see on labels are the ingredients for the wine. Most people know that wine grapes, you know, of course, are in there, but and some yeast. But but there are other aspects to refining a wine. And if you list one ingredient, you got to list them all, apparently. Paul Draper is the CEO and winemaker at Ridge Winery. That's in Cupertino in the Bay Area. And they have begun listing ingredients on the wine labels. Paul joins us right now. And a very good day to you, sir.
Randall, how are you?
Fantastic, thank you. You know, I saw a little clip, I think it was on winebusiness.com a week or so ago, and then it had they had a link to your website, and I watched a video that Ridge put together explaining the ingredient issue, and I thought we got to have you on to talk about this because
kind of you.
Yeah, so are you one of the first to start listing the ingredients?
Well, only if you go back about 30 years when we tried to do this, and the federal authorities that approve your labels said no, you can't do it because we don't require it of anyone else, and that just isn't the way it's going to be.
Oh, you can't mess it up for everyone else.
Exactly. And so, you know, so we backed off. And then about 3, 4, 5 years ago, my friend Randall Graham at Bonnie Doon started putting ingredients on the label, and they didn't object. And we said, oh, my God, we can do it.
Times have changed a little.
Since last year we began.
So Ridge is in the foothills there above Cupertino. Technically, your address is Cupertino?
Yes, the nearest post office. We're up at 2,700 feet above it. And look at the ocean on one side and the bay on the other. It's an old winery built in the 1880s called Montebello.
And technically, that would be the Santa Cruz Mountains?
That's the Santa Cruz Mountains.
Yeah, okay. And that's where your friend's winery is as well. So it's the Santa Cruz Mountains that are on this ingredient kick.
Yes. And, you know, it's more that, one of the things that's come along, which is really interesting because I think it has so many positive aspects, is the idea of natural wine. The trouble is with that you're leaving out what the vineyard provides, that is the character that a specific good vineyard can actually give to a wine. And we get more and more into this thing that the winemaker, which is entirely what a New World American Australian word, that is that we make the wine rather than it's something that actually comes from nature. And that means you get the grapes and then you decide what you want to make from it. You don't allow the place it was grown, the character of the grapes that come off that place, that sense of place, to determine what you make. And so we sort of decided, hey, we want to separate ourselves from that idea and say, yes, we really do want to show sense of place. And we also want to show that to make fine wine, you really don't need all of the additives and processes that are available to a winemaker today. And so we said, let's just list what we do, which is what's been done, for the last 100 years, 200 years, very traditional, very non-invasive additives and effects in making wine.
Interesting. So you're bringing attention to, you know, everyone can grow Pinot Noir or Chardonnay or what have you, but you have this unique condition of soil and what's in the environment around you that makes your wine distinct from someone else's.
Well, yes, that's true, except that a lot of people are in the same position we are, if they'll give their vineyard a chance. That is, there are many, many sites that can produce really distinctive character. And if you don't demand of the ground that it give you huge yields, that is, if you take moderate yields, you can actually see the character that is there. Now, it's true that some areas, some vineyards, just either because you've got the wrong varietal planted or the character of the climate and soil is not going to give you that any distinctive character. It'll be perfectly good, but not very distinctive. But really, a lot of people can do this, and that's the main reason that we're doing it, is to try to encourage more people to go that way, to allow the place, the sense of place where it was grown, to show what's in the wine rather than their winemaking skill.
I see. We're speaking with Paul Draper, CEO winemaker at Ridge Winery in the hills above Cupertino, about listing ingredients on wine labels. Paul, you mentioned some very traditional additives that have been used for the better part of a couple of hundred years or more. What would those include? And then what would the other additives that we might find in some wines made by other winemakers that are just simply not listed on the label?
Well, the traditional ones would be, besides, of course, and this isn't something we set as as something that should be done. But we actually allow the natural yeast that come in on the grapes and the natural, what's called the malolactic bacteria that create a secondary fermentation called malolactic. We don't inoculate for those things, which, 98% of the world does. Because, you know, for thousands of years, those two things have always come in on the grapes. And if you allow them to, they'll do the fermentation and they'll turn grapes into wine without your adding anything. So you don't have to start with that. To add an inoculum, a commercial yeast, commercial malolactic, that's perfectly fine. We don't do it. We don't have to do it. But then the other things would be things like if a grape like Syrah, which really lacks acidity, or Zinfandel, depending on where it's grown, could not have as much as acidity as ideal. You could add a limited amount of tartaric acid, which is the natural acid in wine, and that's been done for a long, long time, more than 100 years.
To boost what wasn't there naturally.
To get a better balance of acidity with the fruit of the wine, the rest of the makeup. You could lower the acidity in some cold areas like we are here in Santa Cruz Mountains. We can get too much natural acidity. And in that case, a traditional way to do it is to add a very small amount of calcium carbonate to precipitate out a very small amount of the acid, again, to get a better balance in the wine.
And that's like what you would find in Tums or something?
I'm not sure. But yes, I suppose it's something that allows some of it that precipitates the acidity. So,
okay.
The other one would be water. If you get, for example, Zinfandel is typical. If it gets really hot during the harvest, Zinfandel will ripen much faster than many other varietals. It'll just go over the top so quickly with heat that you can't keep up and you can't pick all the grapes before they go overripe. And so you've got some fermenters that are just have got more sugar and therefore are going to make a riper wine than you may want, in which case what's happened is that when that heat hit, the vine pulled water back from the grapes to protect itself. And they haven't raisined, but they've lost their plumpness, let's say. Okay, you add a very small amount of water to those particular fermenters to replace the water that was pulled back into the vine, and you have a better balanced wine.
And if you list one ingredient, you got to list them all. So
right.
On the label, it would say water, right?
Like we make a very fine Zinfandel from Benny Ducey's vineyard in Paso.
Mm, mm-hmm.
And, for example, in the 2011, there were a couple of tanks that where we actually had to add a very tiny amount, I think 0.5% or something, of water to balance those wines, and it's on the label. So we have, those are the most non-invasive traditional. The French, for example, where in cool climates for years they've never gotten enough ripeness. They are today with a little global warming. But that is, they would add sugar, a thing invented by a guy named Chaptal. They call it chaptalization. And they'd add sugar to get better ripeness.
Oh, okay.
And if it's done with a really light touch, again, it improves the wine rather than...
I think we just lost him there. Well, that was Paul Draper, CEO winemaker at Ridge Winery in the Cooper, hills above Cupertino. It's right at the end of the segment, so Paul, your timing was okay. We could have talked to him for the whole hour.
I know. I have two more questions for him.
I know. Fascinating. We have to have him back on.
Yes.
So, Paul, we will have you back on. Paul Draper, CEO winemaker, where they are listing the ingredients now. A great wine there at Ridge Vineyards. You're listening to Eat, Drink, Explore. We're back in a moment with our travel deals segment.
Randall White here, host of Eat, Drink, Explore Radio, with a tip for Central Coast wine tasting. Eberle Winery was recently voted Winery of the Year by the world's top sommeliers and has one of the best local tours, according to Wine Spectator. Eberle Winery opened daily 10 to 6, and the winery's cave tours and wine tasting always complimentary. It's easy to find, too. Located on Highway 46 East, just 3.5 miles from Highway 101. Now it's time to plan your visit. Just head to eberlewinery.com.
Hello, this is Julia Louis-Dreyfus, and I want to tell you about my new favorite discovery, Yosemite National Park. I recently went there with my husband and children, and we walked the trails to see the breathtaking waterfalls, admired the grand meadows and giant sequoias. But the future of our national parks is uncertain. Many challenges face our parks today, from polluted air and water to development threats outside their borders and inadequate funding to protect our national heritage. That's why the National Parks Conservation Association recently completed a decade-long assessment of the challenges facing our national parks, along with proposed actions that will ensure our children and grandchildren will be able to enjoy the parks as we have. Our national parks have inspired Americans for nearly 100 years. As we approach the centennial of the National Park Service in 2016, please join us in helping to protect our national park legacy. Find out how at www.mpca.org.
Randall White here, host of Eat, Drink, Explore Radio, with a tip for Central Coast wine tasting. Eberle Winery was recently voted Winery of the Year by the world's top sommeliers and has one of the best local tours, according to Wine Spectator. Eberle Winery opened daily 10 to 6, and the winery's cave tours and wine tasting always complimentary. It's easy to find, too. Located on Highway 46 East, just 3.5 miles from Highway 101. Now it's time to plan your visit. Just head to eberlewinery.com.
The Eat, Drink, Explore Media radio show you are currently enjoying is in a local affiliate commercial break. Live programming will return shortly. Did you know you can watch a live video simulcast of our Sunday morning and Thursday evening shows from your computer, smartphone, or tablet device? And to top it off, it's free. Simply head to eatdrinkexplore.com. Or download our free app from the Google Play or Apple App Store. If you have a suggestion for an upcoming guest segment, send an email to radio@eatdrinkexplore.com. We're always looking for fresh ideas, including yours. We love to share fresh, local, organic, seasonal, and sustainable ideas throughout the week. And the best place to find those are on our Twitter, YouTube, and Facebook feeds. Our username across the social networking universe is simple: Eat, Drink, Explore, all one word. Hey, college students, Eat, Drink, Explore Media is always looking for qualified journalism or marketing interns. Send us an email today so we can check your status and put you on the list for upcoming intern vacancies. Would you like to hear this Eat, Drink, Explore radio program on one of your local radio stations? Let the station know and contact us as well so we can get the ball rolling. Okay, you made it. The local affiliate commercial break is now over. Time for more informative and entertaining programming from Eat, Drink, Explore Media. Thank you for your patience.
You've waited all week, and it's finally here. The Eat, Drink, Explore Weekly Travel Deals Extravaganza.
That's right. 8:49 now the time. By the way, Paul Draper called back to let us know that his phone unit died.
It disconnected right at that moment.
It happens with my parents all the time. So, the troubles of cordless phones.
But we have more questions for him, so we'll have him back on again that we can pick his brain a little bit more. Really interesting stuff.
Maybe even next week for like a part two. So it's right on the heels. But it is time for our travel deal segment. Gabe Saglia, we have him on once a month. It is the first Sunday of the month. It happens to be Cinco de Mayo this week. And he joins us with his selections from the weekly top 20. Hey, Gabe.
Hello. Happy Cinco de Mayo. I should say Feliz Cinco de Mayo.
Feliz, exactly. You have picked out a couple of Cinco de Mayo-themed places for us to visit. Let's start in PV, Puerto Vallarta.
Yeah, Puerto Vallarta. There's a place there called the Casa Magna Marriott Puerto Vallarta Resort and Spa. Four diamond beachfront property, three swimming pools. You're right next to this beautiful 18-hole golf course. $99 a night.
Wow.
And the neat thing about this deal is that it comes with a 50-minute spa treatment per person daily. Yeah, great. You can't beat that. That's the way to travel all the way through the summer months. And, of course, south of the border, this is now, you know, Cinco de Mayo does sort of open the window to a couple of months now as we head towards summer of some really aggressive deals south of the border. So Puerto Vallarta, yeah. It's
Wow.
Property right on the beach.
That, did you say a 50-minute spa treatment per day?
Oh. Yeah.
Wow.
15 would just be a tease. I mean,
right.
That's 50, as it is, it's never long enough. But, you know, yeah, it's 50. Yeah, they got a nice
Wow.
Spot.
Let's hop across the country to the other side, Riviera Maya, which has just exploded tourism-wise recently, right?
Yeah, this is obviously, you know, Riviera Maya, the most popular place on that eastern stretch of Mexico. This is with airfare out of Los Angeles. And you go to Cancun, you spend four nights at a place called the Akumal Beach Resort, upscale property, beautiful beach location, several restaurants. They got an arts and crafts market there, so you're immersing yourself in the cultural aspect of traveling south of the border. And it's all-inclusive, so with airfare out of L.A., four nights all-inclusive, $6.99, and that includes an upgrade to an ocean view room. That's travel now through September, again, the summer months, and the kids 11 and under stay and eat for free, which means you're only paying for their airfare, which is a few hundred bucks.
Wow, that is awesome. Okay, so we're heading to San Francisco next, huh?
So, you know, I'm really excited about San Francisco this year. You know, last summer of 2012, average San Francisco hotel prices were higher on average than even New York and Honolulu. It was the number one most expensive domestic city because people were just flocking to the city by the bay. So now what we're seeing is sort of an early push for San Francisco, especially for holiday weekends. So this is from the Fairmont San Francisco, obviously a famous landmark, 4.5-star hotel right on Knob Hill. And specifically for Mother's Day, Memorial Day, 4th of July, and Labor Day weekends, the holiday weekends of the summer months, $199. And rates usually start, you know, $300 up. So $199 for those holiday weekends. That comes with free valet parking. As you know, you're paying when you go to San Francisco to park your car at these hotels, $50+ a night. So to include the free valet parking, that's a big bonus right there on a nightly savings basis.
It's a huge bonus. The Fairmont, so historic as well. Fans of the show Hotel from the late 70s, early 80s will remember it as the that was where it was set.
Uh-huh.
I think it was called the St. Regis or something. But then, I mean, the hotel wasn't, but the fictional hotel
in the
was.
Show, yeah.
Yeah, and then also the, is it the Tiki Lounge that's there? Or what's
the Tonga Room.
The Tonga Room. Isn't that where Tony Bennett first sang I Left My Heart in San Francisco?
I think you're right. And this is, you're walking into... it's right off the, you know, it's off the lobby, but you're walking into this Polynesian paradise, and out of the blue, as you're enjoying your tropical cocktail in the tiki cup, thunder, lightning, rain showers, not on you but around you.
I love it,
and it's really cool.
Also, here's a little fact, Gabe. You may or may not know this: the very first concierge in the United States. Still work. Well, I'm not sure that he still works there. He was as of a few years ago.
Okay.
Working at the Fairmont. That's where the whole tradition began here in the U.S.
Wow.
He brought it over from France. Great guy. I've spoken with him many times.
That's really cool.
And actually, I believe that this hotel is the very first Fairmont hotel ever. Like, this hotel launched the Fairmont brand.
Yeah.
Which these days, as you know, is synonymous with, you know, upscale, white glove type of service. Neat place. I've stayed there. Highly recommend it. It's the only spot, by the way, there on Knob Hill where all of the cable lines
come together,
the cable car lines in San Francisco converge. So anywhere you want to get to in the city on those lines, hop, skip, and a jump.
One last thing. It was where my senior prom was held for high school. And I went to school with the granddaughters of the Swigs, who were the owners of the Fairmont. Mm-hmm. So that's why it was held there. You
that
know?
Makes wow. sense.
And I love that hotel. So I'm really glad you included it on the list. All right, let's go down to SoCal, 90210.
Yeah, so this is a great place called the Mr. C Hotel. Now, if you've been to New York, you know the Cipriani enterprise there, some of the better restaurants in New York City are the Cipriani restaurants. Well, that family opened up a hotel about a year, year and a half ago in Beverly Hills. There's a Cipriani restaurant in that hotel, but it's called a Mr. C, five-star hotel. You're about a mile from Rodeo Drive. They've got their bathrooms are made from Carrara marble, Italian bed linens, custom furnishings, very neat place. $259 a night. Usually it's $400 plus. $259 a night. They even throw in a bottle of Prosecco when you check in. Best to travel all the way through June.
Wow, really nice. Yeah. Okay, so where are we heading next, Gabe?
Lake Arrowhead. Well,
Lake Arrowhead. Mm-hmm. Have you been there? You know, in the heart of the San Bernardino Mountains, Lake Arrowhead. You're at about 6,500 feet above sea level. There's a place there right on the shores of the lake called the Lake Arrowhead Resort and Spa. Four-star property. A two-night stay there, $229 now for the summer months, which is a huge deal. The prices will go way up if you wait last minute to book you for the summer months. But $229 gets you a two-night stay, breakfast daily, and a $50 spa credit. And you're literally on the shores of Lake Arrowhead, so if you like to do the, you know, the boating, they've got their own little private beach there as well. Yeah, beautiful place, great weather over the summer.
And then continue out the 10 or the 15, I forget which it is, all the way out to Las Vegas. I have not heard of this resort, the M, the letter M Resort.
Yeah, relatively new property, the M Resort. It's a Four Diamonds property about 10 minutes away from Mandalay Bay, so just south of the Strip itself. They shuttle you there for free. Whenever you want to get to the Strip, they'll take you there for free. But the hotel itself, huge acre, their pool itself is an acre.
Whoa.
So it's just mega, you know, mega pool. And the deal there now is $110 a night, but the third night's free, which brings your per night room rate down to like $74, and you get 2-for-1 frozen cocktails by the pool.
Very nice.
I like that.
Yeah, can't go wrong with that.
Okay, so your next stop is in my hometown, and my mom lives literally just maybe 2 blocks from this location. Oh, we're running out of time.
Yeah, we need about 20 seconds.
Arizona Biltmore, Oprah Winfrey, and every president since Herbert Hoover has stayed here. $129 a night, mega luxurious property, and it includes breakfast for a family of four at that $129 rate.
Gabe Saglia, his top picks for the week from TravelZoo. You can go to TravelZoo.com or follow the link at eatdrinkexplore.com. Gabe, thank you so much for joining us again, as always.
You got it, man. I'll see you next month. Safe travels.
All right. Stick around, everyone, because just after the break, we will be speaking with a man who took on Caltrans because he didn't like the lack of signage on one particular issue. That and so much more coming up in the next hour. You're listening to the Eat, Drink, Explore Sunday Funday Show. I'm your host, Randall White, joined by the lovely and talented Patty Fiburn. We're back in just a moment.
The Eat, Drink, Explore Media radio show you are currently enjoying is in a local affiliate commercial break. Live programming will return shortly. Did you know you can watch a live video simulcast of our Sunday morning and Thursday evening shows from your computer, smartphone, or tablet device? And to top it off, it's free. Simply head to eatdrinkexplore.com. or download our free app from the Google Play or Apple App Store. If you have a suggestion for an upcoming guest segment, send an email to radio@eatdrinkexplore.com. We're always looking for fresh ideas, including yours. We love to share fresh, local, organic, seasonal, and sustainable ideas throughout the week. And the best place to find those are on our Twitter, YouTube, and Facebook feeds. Our username across the social networking universe is simple: Eat, Drink, Explore, all one word. Hey, college students, Eat, Drink, Explore Media is always looking for qualified journalism or marketing interns. Send us an email today so we can check your status and put you on the list for upcoming intern vacancies. Would you like to hear this Eat, Drink, Explore radio program on one of your local radio stations? Let the station know and contact us as well so we can get the ball rolling. Okay, you made it.
The local affiliate commercial break is now over. Time for more informative and entertaining programming from Eat, Drink, Explore Media. Thank you for your patience.
You're listening to the Eat, Drink, Explore Radio Network, live every Sunday with the very latest food, beverage, and travel trends.
Fabulous.
Now here's the host of our show, Mr. Randall White.
That's right. A very good morning, everyone. 9 o'clock straight up here on the Eat, Drink, Explore Radio Network. A very good morning to our Crush 92.5 listeners in San Luis Obispo County, northern Santa Barbara County, wherever you might be listening if you're online. Hey, drop us a note. Radio@eatdrinkexplore.com. We always like to hear the... if you're from far away,
yeah,
you know. So this hour of Eat, Drink, Explore Radio brought to you by the fantastic people there at Eberly Winery in Paso Robles. They are open daily from 10 in the morning until 6 o'clock in the evening with complimentary wine tasting and cave tours, voted by Wine Spectator as one of the best tours on the Central Coast. Eberly Winery, located on 46 East in Paso Robles. You can log on to eberlywinery.com for more information. If you visit their tasting room today or in the coming days, make sure you let them know you heard about them on Eat, Drink, Explore Radio. That helps us out a lot when you do. Okay, so today is the big flavor of slow.
Yeah.
I always want to go, flavor, flav, when I hear that. You remember that this was the first year that they got rid of the taste of slow.
Right.
And so I keep wanting to say taste of slow, but mm-hmm. No, it is the flavor of slow.
Held
at the historic Jack House there on Marsh Street in downtown San Luis Obispo, a fine location for weddings and that sort of thing. Or... for an event that highlights great food and wine
right.
from the area. And beer, too, I would imagine. But we are giving away a pair of tickets to this wonderful event. And joining us on the line right now is Miles Fairchild. He's with Flavor of Slow to tell us about the festivities for the day. Hello, Miles.
Hey, Randall. How's it going?
Great. Thank you. The weather's a little on the cool side, so it could have gone in any possible direction these last 3 or 4 days. I imagine you're happy that it's not reaching near 100 degrees, but maybe this is a little cool.
Yeah, we were saying it actually might be to our benefit. It's a little chilly out, but I think it's going to warm up a little bit more in the afternoon as it goes on.
That's good. Yeah. How many people are you expecting?
We usually expect around 200 to 300. That's kind of the range of people we usually expect.
So what are some of the highlights for the people who come out today? What are they going to be flavoring? I was going to say tasting.
right.
There is some tasting going on. We have local vineyards that are going to be here, and we also have a bunch of local breweries. It's actually the most breweries we've had at the event so far. We have about 6 local breweries, and we have a lot of local food places as well. Just to name a few, F. McClintock's, Motav, Mama Ganache, Poncho's, just some local favorites.
It really should be a lot of fun, and I'd rather be on the cool side than the hot side as well.
Right.
I agree. So we're giving away a pair of tickets, and let's see, I already switched over here. I was telling people that it was really, you might as well sign up because... your odds are great.
Right.
So 23 people that jumped on this possibility. And after putting it in our little randomizer here, Tracy Hall from San Luis Obispo. Tracy Hall is the winner of those 2 tickets. And we'll send you that information, Miles, so that they'll just go to the will call booth.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, I was asking you.
No. Basically, just make sure they bring their photo ID, and because alcohol is being served, obviously, we need to check that out for them before they come in.
And we had, and thank you for the tickets we gave away on our Thursday evening show as well. A couple of happy people there that are going, and so 4 tickets in total that we gave away to the Flavor of Slow for today. And good luck with the event. I hope it works out for you.
Thank you, Randall. Really appreciate it.
We'll hit it up next year. We have some Cinco de Mayo stuff going on today. All right. Take care, Miles. Stick around, everyone. Just after the break here, we're going to learn about you're not supposed to put your own signs up when it comes to traffic. But the one man did. We're back in just a moment here on the Eat, Drink, Explore Radio Network.
Hey, Farmers Market fans, listen up, because we're launching a new show just for you. Join the Eat, Drink, Explore Radio Network each Thursday evening from 5:30 to 6 for a healthy dose of recipe sharing and food news. We broadcast our show live from the historic downtown San Luis Obispo Farmers Market, but the information shared is designed for anyone who has a love of fresh, seasonal produce and locally made artisan treats. So whether your favorite market is located at San Francisco's Ferry Plaza in downtown Santa Monica, or if you're simply a member of a CSA, you'll love our weekly Market Fresh, available live each Thursday evening at eatdrinkexplore.com. And if you missed the show, follow our updates on Facebook and Twitter for links to the recipes shared, video from the show, and other great information. Eat, Drink, Explore Radio's Market Fresh, helping perfect your California flavor.
You're listening to the Eat, Drink, Explore Radio Network.
Fabulous.
Live every Sunday with the very latest food, beverage, and travel trends.
Amazing.
Now here's the host of our show, Mr. Randall White.
And a very good morning to you on this Sunday fun day. 9:06 the time. Great to have you joining us here on the Eat, Drink, Explore Radio Network. This is where Californians come to talk about all things food, beverage, and travel. And we like to give you the information that you can use so that you can get the most out of your California life in a healthy and sustainable manner. Maybe even sprinkled in with a little community support.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm joined by Patty Pyburn. That's the you heard in the background. And coming up here on the show, we have lots of great guests, including glowing plants. These are plants.
So cool.
It really is cool. And they are cool to the touch.
Yes.
It's an incredibly efficient light that is emitted from these plants. It's a genetic process that has been perfected, I guess, or on the way to
engineered
in San Francisco company.
Mm-hmm.
That is it's a Kickstarter thing.
Super cool.
Uh-huh. And they are, at one day, they're hoping that you could light entire city streets with trees that are glowing.
I love it.
How cool is that? Or it's
a garden path with plants.
Yeah. In the near future, it's never going to be so much that you'd have to do away with all your light bulbs in the house, but perhaps you could get rid of your night lights and that sort of thing.
Really, really cool. Really awesome.
It is. I was thinking about, what's that movie that was completely computer generated and they lived on a planet that was, what is it? Avatar.
Thank you, Ricardo. Right.
Yeah.
Yes,
in Avatar, I think they had trees that glowed, right?
Yeah, yes. Uh-huh. Yes, they did.
So anyway.
Very cool.
We'll be speaking with Anthony Evans. He's the bioengineer behind these glowing plants. And then the final half hour, we will be talking stealthy, healthy cookies.
Undercover cookies.
Undercover cookies. I love it. It's some women that got together. Remember, California has that new bakery law cottage food law where you can make things at home now and sell them at farmers markets and stores and that sort of thing,
and it's helped pave the way for a lot of businesses like Undercover Cookies.
I love it. So we'll be looking at a successful example from this new law that has passed. But right now we want to talk about a story that I saw in the Marin Independent Journal this past week, and I heard it on a public radio station, KQED, out of San Francisco as well, and I thought, you know what, I gotta get this guy on the line, because I have driven this.
Maybe we can get him to work down here too.
Yes, we have roadways where this is a problem for sure. But for anyone familiar with Marin County, when you're over on the Mill Valley side of Mount Tamalpais and the coast and that sort of thing, you have, in order to get to the coast, you have to go up and over a portion of Mount Tamalpais, and then you drop down into Stinson Beach and Muir Beach, and it is windy. A stretch of it is a really tree covered. covered, and George Lucas used it for one of the Ewok scenes where
they
were flying through the trees, if you remember that. Yeah. I think that was in Empire Strikes Back. And in fact, yesterday was May the 4th. And everyone on Facebook was saying, "May the 4th be with you."
Oh, gosh.
It was Star Wars Day. I thought that was funny. So anyway, I'm getting way off topic. Yeah. But anyway, this stretch of Highway 1, if you're familiar with that drive, you can...
You're comfortable with it.
You're comfortable with it. So you can do it at the recommended speeds.
And for people who the scenery is new, there's that Sunday driver thing comes because you're looking. You want to look at all what's surrounding you. And it's hard to do on windy, twisty, narrow roads.
Right. Well, you're breaking the law if you do it too slowly, and one man that lives in Muir Beach wanted to let drivers know that, and he wanted Caltrans to help him out with that, but they dragged their feet, according to him, and he finally just decided, I'm going to do this myself.
He took matters into his own hands.
Right. So joining us on the line right now is Gerald Perlman, and he's the man behind some signs that he put up. They're nice looking signs, I think, that says, "Hey, slow vehicles with five or more following must use a turnout." Gerald, welcome to Eat, Drink, Explore Radio.
Yes. Hello.
Yeah, we're excited to have you on the line, because at what point did you reach the frustration level and just decided, forget Caltrans, I'm going to do this myself?
Well, at what point is a year and a half later after my first initial request to them and their promises over all of that period of time to actually do something. So, the frustration just mounts and mounts and mounts. And then after the last communication with them, when they said, it'll be up there on the second week in April, and it didn't. And that, that's the way it's been. They've said things before, and they never followed through with them. So then I said, I can't wait around any longer. It's just too frustrating. Mm-hmm. And it felt good to do something.
Yeah, I bet it did. Yeah.
So has Caltrans responded to you putting up your own signs? Because they probably, along with this, slow vehicle law, there's probably something that says you can't put up your own signs, I imagine, right?
I don't know. That would be kind of a First Amendment issue. I think that under the First Amendment, you can't, it's free speech, something like that. So I'm not quite sure that they haven't responded, except I think to one news inquiry, they did say that they're going to replace those signs with signs of their own. But I'm not sure about that. Nobody's responded to me except a lot of people around here who were very much supportive of what I did.
Yeah, so what is the law exactly?
Well, the law, as I understand it, says that vehicles with five or more vehicles behind them must use the pullouts.
And there are plenty of pullouts along that stretch. I've driven it, and I've been behind people that don't use it, so I know that frustration that you're talking about where you scream out loud in your own car, why didn't you just pull over?
Yeah, in addition to that, as I said, the main thing is the public safety issue, because, no matter how much you try, you end up tailgating them, and you pull back. But because you drive at your normal pace, you're back tailgating them in a few minutes, and eventually. And we did have actually one accident a couple of weeks ago that had to do with pullouts.
I imagine too, Gerald, that for some drivers, we have some narrow winding roadways. 154 comes to mind, where you've got traffic going one lane each direction, and you get people who get risky and they go out into the other lane of traffic to pass, and then that becomes dangerous.
That becomes very dangerous with blind curves on the road. So, it was in everybody's best interest that this be dealt with in an expeditious manner, and yet it dragged on and on and on and on to the point where I said, no more, I can't wait around anymore.
How many signs total did you put up?
Three.
And coming down Mount Tam toward Muir Beach?
No, they that is also a problem, of course, but our problem for the Muir Beach residents is more, although we obviously go both ways, but there was one sign way up on the top about when you're coming down, but there was no signs when you're going up.
Oh, okay.
And that's where I put mine, on the right side, rather than going. What do you call it? South
Muir Beach. Well, that's where the Pelican Inn is, correct?
That's correct, and there's one sign right before the Pelican Inn.
I love the Pelican Inn. It's a great great place to, on a day like today specifically, to kind of hunker down and have a nice beer and bite to eat. Well, that does it for this segment, but I really appreciate you joining us to talk a little bit about your battle there, and I hope those Caltrans signs get put up quickly on many stretches of roadway here in the state. Gerald Perlman, the man behind the Highway 1 signs, and I want to thank the Marin Independent Journal as well for a photo that we're showing of Gerald there underneath one of the signs.
All right.
Thank you, Gerald. I used to be a paper delivery boy for the...
For the Marin Independent.
Marin Independent Journal, that's right. All right, we're back in just a moment, everyone. You're listening to the Eat, Drink, Explore Radio Network. Glowing Plants up next.
May is National Bike Month. Now, I used to be intimidated at the thought of biking to work. I worried about my outfit, the traffic, and the time. But my expanding waistline and rising gas prices helped me rethink that position. And last May, I tried riding to work. What an amazing change. In the years since I started riding to work, I've lost weight, saved money on gas, and canceled my gym membership. You should try it. Here are a few tips to help you get started. Alter your route for biking. Cars and bikes are both vehicles and both have a right to the road, but you'll feel more comfortable and more able to enjoy your ride if you choose less traveled streets. Ride with a friend the first few times. Someone who has experience biking to work. They'll help you figure out how to carry your clothes, where to park your bike, and the easiest way to get to the office. Follow all the same rules you follow while driving. Signal before you turn, stop at all stop signs, and stay in the rightmost lane going in your direction. Biking to work is fun, easy, and enjoyable. Try it. For more tips and techniques on how to commute by bicycle or to find other cyclists in your area, visit bikeleague.org.
Can we have your attention for a moment? Eat, Drink, Explore Media has an important date we want to share with you. Saturday, July 13th. We invite you to join us at a craft beer and food event like no other. At Last Count, generous samples from more than 70 breweries will be paired with local culinary treats for the 2013 Breast Fest along San Francisco's waterfront at Fort Mason. Going on its 14th year, the annual Breast Fest has grown dramatically, raising money for an incredibly important cause, providing free complimentary treatments for women battling breast cancer. The Charlotte Maxwell Clinic offers services such as acupuncture, massage, organic foods, and transportation. The clinic's core mission to provide relief from the terrible side effects of cancer and its treatments. Eat, Drink, Explore Media is very proud to be among the main sponsors for this year's event. For more information, go to thebreastfest.org.
The Eat, Drink, Explore Media radio show you are currently enjoying is in a local affiliate commercial break. Live programming will return shortly. Did you know you can watch a live video simulcast of our Sunday morning and Thursday evening shows from your computer, smartphone, or tablet device? And to top it off, it's free. Simply head to eatdrinkexplore.com. Or download our free app from the Google Play or Apple App Store. If you have a suggestion for an upcoming guest segment, send an email to radio@eatdrinkexplore.com. We're always looking for fresh ideas, including yours. We love to share fresh, local, organic, seasonal, and sustainable ideas throughout the week. And the best place to find those are on our Twitter, YouTube, and Facebook feeds. Our username across the social networking universe is simple. Eat, Drink, Explore, all one word. Hey, college students, Eat, Drink, Explore Media is always looking for qualified journalism or marketing interns. Send us an email today so we can check your status and put you on the list for upcoming intern vacancies. Would you like to hear this Eat, Drink, Explore radio program on one of your local radio stations? Let the station know and contact us as well so we can get the ball rolling. Okay, you made it. The local affiliate commercial break is now over. Time for more informative and entertaining programming from Eat, Drink, Explore Media. Thank you for your patience. 9:19 now, the time here on this Sunday Funday morning. You're listening to the Eat, Drink, Explore Radio Network. Great to have you with us. And this next segment comes to us via the power of Twitter. So I guess it's appropriate that the bird is chirping in the background.
Yes.
I was online the other day, and I saw this post about, it was a woman that I follow, and I think she's on the East Coast, and she's like, well, I just donated to a Kickstarter campaign for glowing plants. Very cool. So it's like,
very cool.
So I was like, glowing plants, huh? You know, so, and I'm always kind of interested in the Kickstarter things.
Right.
So, which for people that don't know is crowdsourcing to fund your projects.
For investments, yeah. Very cool.
And so I thought, I'm going to check this out. So I followed the link on her tweet and started looking at this really incredible project that is underway in San Francisco. Of course, so many of the new technologies and those sorts of things do come out of the Bay Area because it's just a hotbed for that sort of thing. And so when I saw that these plants could one day potentially light streets and bedrooms and stuff like that. And
really cool.
I thought, oh, okay, we got it. We need to have them on the line right now. And so that's exactly what we have. We have one of the founders, Anthony Evans, with a glowing plant in San Francisco, bioengineering plants to emit light. Anthony, you'd never know I lived in that city. Thanks for welcome to the program, sir.
Good morning. Hi.
Yeah. Hi. Thank you so much. How on earth did you get on track to start making glowing plants?
So, you know, one of the interesting, exciting things about this project is that, you know, while the rest of the world sort of has not really heard of this idea before, actually glowing plants have been around for a pretty long time within synthetic biology and scientific circles. And one of my co-founders, Omri, he has built a software that lets you create your own genetic design called Genome Compiler, and he was at Google's Soul4X conference last year, and he sort of talked about this project as an example of something that you might one day do with his software, and a lot of people got very excited about it and thought it was a cool idea. So, you know, he sort of decided to let's do it, let's make it happen, and he approached me last August at Singularity University, which is a small sort of entrepreneurship technology sort of institute in Moffett Field in Mountain View. And I just fell in love with the idea really, really fast and thought, you know, I've got to help this guy make it happen. And we started going along to the bioluminescent meetup at BioCurious, which is a do-it-yourself biology lab in Sunnyvale. And we went along there, and it turned out that there was this guy named Kyle, and he was already working on it as well. So, you know, we started working together, we joined forces, and you know, this is where we are.
So at this point in the process, how much light will a plant emit? Like, how bright would it make the environment around it?
Like a nightlight, maybe?
Yeah, maybe like a nightlight. I mean, these first plants are going to be, you know, quite dim. This is the start of a pretty long process. The sort of model that we're looking at for this is something more like glow in the dark paint, or you know, like a firefly. So, you know, something that you need to see in a dark room. But you know, one day hopefully we can build on this work and create something that lights up our streets.
Now, this light does exist in nature. You brought up fireflies, and I know there are some other species as well that create their own light,
like in the ocean, for instance.
Yeah. So, is that what you're doing? Right. You're taking genes from those plants or animals, and then splicing them into the plants?
Yeah, exactly. We're actually taking genes from an organism called Vibrio fischeri, which is a small marine bacteria. And it has all the genes inside it that creates two chemicals. One is called luciferase, which is an enzyme, and then the other is genes that code for a small molecule called luciferin. And when luciferin and luciferase get together with some oxygen, they react to create light. It's called cold light because it's obviously very, very efficient. It doesn't create any heat as a byproduct, so all the energy that you put in comes out as light.
Oh, cold light. Okay, yeah.
Interesting.
That is interesting. And so I would imagine there is some hesitation, especially in the Bay Area and portions of California, when it comes to genetically modified plants. Typically, the kind that we ingest are the ones that raise red flags. Would these plants be able to spread and possibly work their way into the natural vegetation of the area?
These plants are fertile. One of the things that we want to do is, you know, a lot of the criticism of genetically engineered food like this is that, you know, large corporations are attempting to take over and control the food supply, and that people have understandably quite large reservations about that. So one of the things that we're doing is making sure that we, you know, we're creating this as an open source product. It's on an open source license. And so, you know, anyone else who wants to build on top of this work will be able to do so themselves. You know, if you get the seeds, you'll be able to create offspring of them. But we don't expect them to spread, you know, really far in the environment. You know, the plant that we're using is not native to the area. It won't survive very well in the wild. You know, it's more of a house plant that needs quite a lot of looking after to make sure that you keep it. You know, it doesn't like being in direct sunlight. If it gets more than 25 degrees, Celsius, it really struggles. So, you know, it's a pretty safe plant. We think there's a very low risk of it spreading. It doesn't have many similar species, so the risk of cross-pollination of the genes is extremely low. You know, this plant is basically about as safe as you can get with something like this.
Do you think eventually you might use this, what you learn with this sort of hard-to-care-for plant, would you ever apply it in something a little hardier?
Like a tree where you could light streets?
Yeah, that's the longer-term vision. So, you know, we're starting with a small plant. We're using a plant called Arabidopsis. And this, as I mentioned, it's a pretty good plant for one reason, that it's unlikely to sort of get wildly out of hand. But it's also been really well studied by scientists. So this is called a model organism. And because it's got one of the shortest genomes of any plant, and because it's got relatively short life cycle, scientists have been studying this for a really long time.
So you've already...
That's one reason why we chose this plant.
You've already exceeded your... I'm sorry.
but the plan is for the future to really work on the brightness first and then to go to bigger plants. You know, we've announced a stretch goal that if we can get to 400K in backers, then on Kickstarter, so you can go and look at the project if you type glowing plant into Kickstarter. If we get to 400K, then we will put this into a rose as well, and we will try and make a glowing rose. And so that will be a little bit of a bigger plant. And then over time, we work on bigger things.
That's exactly what I was going to say, how that you've already exceeded your initial goal on Kickstarter, and now you have a higher goal, and you're well on your way to reaching that, which is the beginning of June. You need to hit that number, right?
Yeah, we have to get there before June 6th.
Before
the way Kickstarter works, for people who aren't familiar, is you have a sort of a finite campaign of somewhere between 30 and 60 days, and you try and raise your money in that period, and then you go and work on the products. But in our case, it's going to take about 6 to 12 months to actually work on this technology and get seeds ready that we send out to people who supported us.
I imagine the natural, or well, I guess it wouldn't be natural selection, but the selection process would be very easy, because you just need to turn off the lights and look at all the plants you have, and the brightest ones, you keep those and ditch the others, right?
That's exactly how it works. Yeah, we don't need to introduce any kind of herbicide resistance or any of these other things, because we can use light as a marker.
Yeah, I think that's fantastic. Well, Anthony Evans with a glowing plant in San Francisco. The Kickstarter campaign, like he said, just search glowing plant and you'll find it right there. Thanks for joining us this morning. Good luck with the campaign and the project.
Thanks for having me. Have a good day.
All right, stick around, everyone. Straight ahead, we're going to learn about making stealthy, healthy cookies. That's straight ahead on the Eat, Drink, Explore Radio Network. I'm your host, Randall White, joined by Patty Pyburn. We're back in just a moment.
Can we have your attention for a moment? Eat, Drink, Explore Media has an important date we want to share with you. Saturday, July 13th. We invite you to join us at a craft beer and food event like no other. At last count, generous samples from more than 70 breweries will be paired with local culinary treats for the 2013 Breast Fest along San Francisco's waterfront at Fort Mason. Going on its 14th year, the annual Breast Fest has grown dramatically, raising money for an incredibly important cause, providing free, complimentary treatments for women battling breast cancer. The Charlotte Maxwell Clinic offers services such as acupuncture, massage, organic foods, and transportation. The clinic's core mission to provide relief from the terrible side effects of cancer and its treatments. Eat, Drink, Explore Media is very proud to be among the main sponsors for this year's event. For more information, go to thebreastfest.org.
May is National Bike Month. Now, I used to be intimidated at the thought of biking to work. I worried about my outfit, the traffic, and the time. But my expanding waistline and rising gas prices helped me rethink that position. And last May, I tried riding to work. What an amazing change. In the years since I started riding to work, I've lost weight, saved money on gas, and canceled my gym membership. You should try it. Here are a few tips to help you get started. Alter your route for biking. Cars and bikes are both vehicles and both have a right to the road, but you'll feel more comfortable and more able to enjoy your ride if you choose less traveled streets. Ride with a friend the first few times, someone who has experience biking to work. They'll help you figure out how to carry your clothes, where to park your bike, and the easiest way to get to the office. Follow all the same rules you follow while driving. Signal before you turn, stop at all stop signs, and stay in the rightmost lane going in your direction. Biking to work is fun, easy, and enjoyable. Try it. For more tips and techniques on how to commute by bicycle or to find other cyclists in your area, visit bikeleague.org.
The Eat, Drink, Explore Media radio show you are currently enjoying is in a local affiliate commercial break. Live programming will return shortly. Did you know you can watch a live video simulcast of our Sunday morning and Thursday evening shows from your computer, smartphone, or tablet device? And to top it off, it's free. Simply head to eatdrinkexplore.com or download our free app from the Google Play or Apple App Store. If you have a suggestion for an upcoming guest segment, send an email to radio@eatdrinkexplore.com. We're always looking for fresh ideas, including yours. We love to share fresh, local, organic, seasonal, and sustainable ideas throughout the week. And the best place to find those are on our Twitter, YouTube, and Facebook feeds. Our username across the social networking universe is simple. Eat, Drink, Explore, all one word. Hey, college students, Eat, Drink, Explore Media is always looking for qualified journalism or marketing interns. Send us an email today so we can check your status and put you on the list for upcoming intern vacancies. Would you like to hear this Eat, Drink, Explore radio program on one of your local radio stations? Let the station know and contact us as well so we can get the ball rolling. Okay, you made it. The local affiliate commercial break is now over. Time for more informative and entertaining programming from Eat, Drink, Explore Media. Thank you for your patience.
Welcome back to the Eat, Drink, Explore radio network. Here now is your fabulous host, Mr. Randall White.
And a very good day, everyone. 9:33 now the time here on the Eat, Drink, Explore radio network. Great to have you with us for this final half hour of the program. We are going to focus on what is dubbed stealthy healthy this half hour. A lot of people who have dietary restrictions, whether self-imposed or because they need to, can't often have baked goods that they would, you know, you don't want to cut some of life's pleasures out of your treats or your, you know, your daily diet. And so, you know, we're talking about people that have to avoid gluten for one reason or another. There are varying degrees of gluten intolerance.
Right. Or dairy.
Or dairy, for that matter. Mm-hmm. And then you might do that just because it upsets your stomach.
Right.
Or you might be vegan. And so you cut out.
So it's just a lifestyle choice.
So a lifestyle choice. In either case, a lot of baked goods have all those ingredients in them. But now you can. Something called Undercover Cookies allows people that are either vegan or gluten intolerant to chow down on some really tasty morsels. And joining us in the studio right now is Valerie. Oh, you know what? I put the pronouncer right on here, Valerie. Manzoros.
Good, yeah.
I got it right on.
Perfect.
Fantastic, yes. And so, Valerie, you and two of your friends got together and decided to, when the law changed in California for a cottage, what's it called? The cottage industry
the
law?
Cottage law.
Yeah, the cottage law went into effect. Did you say, oh, this is a perfect opening for us to start a bakery?
Yeah, it was perfect timing because we'd already been brainstorming and thinking, and I'd already been making these cookies. So when we heard about that, everyone was like telling us, oh my gosh, this is perfect for you guys. So you guys can, it was just perfect because we didn't have a lot of resources to start and we were small and just the idea. So it let us, you know, get it started without a lot of overhead.
And that's the problem for a lot of people that want to start a baking or any sort of food related thing. Prior to this law, you had to secure an industrial kitchen that met all sorts of guidelines, and it was such a pricey endeavor for such a small priced item. It kept a lot of people out of the loop.
Yeah
But not anymore.
So the health inspector comes right to your house and inspects it, and there are still guidelines, things that you have to follow, but you know, they're manageable. You can, you know, it's easier than all, you know, and less expensive than all that,
especially when you're just getting started. Right.
And
you're not really sure what your market's going to be yet.
Yeah, and this allows us to test the market and see what people like and not be afraid to just kind of evolve as we go. You know, we don't have to have everything planned and have everything perfect right from the beginning.
Right.
And, you know, we're still evolving now, and eventually we'll outgrow it, but it's a great way to start.
And so how did you decide that you wanted to create cookies that were gluten-free or available for vegans and that sort of thing? How did you narrow your scope?
It was mostly selfish because I'm vegan and I'm gluten-free because I have a lot of dietary restrictions. So I wasn't eating that myself because I was diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis and they told me to cut all that stuff out.
Oh, okay.
So I had been trying to eat that way for a long time and I couldn't find any good cookies. So I just come up with this recipe on my own. And then when we were thinking, okay, what do we want to do? We were thinking a cafe and it seemed a little bit overwhelming at the time. So we said, well, let's start with one thing. We decided to go with a cookie and then it kind of took off from there.
Okay. So like you said, it was selfish, but there are a lot of people out there who have the same, you know, eating habits that you have that are probably saying, oh, thank goodness someone finally did this. Because I know Anthony right across the room over here has some diet restrictions. I have an uncle and a cousin who, when they finally discovered that they were gluten intolerant, it really changed their life. And they thought for years, had we only known this, you know, but when it's really difficult when they come to visit and I have to think about how to cook for them and have food for them.
Yeah,
there are not a lot of good options.
Yeah, it's hard to eat out. It's hard to just have that treat. You know, you look at the label and it's just like it cuts out most everything. And then everyone, you know, kind of gets left out, or it's uncomfortable, or it's hard to plan for those friends.
Or for kids. They don't.
Or kids.
Little ones don't understand why they can't have what everyone else
is
having.
Exactly. And their friends are having it and they feel left out. So.
And you don't always want to be the one in the room. I know Anthony feels this way where you're like, oh, no, not me. Let me just make an announcement that I make on a daily basis. I'm gluten intolerant. And, you know.
Right. Yeah. Everyone's looking at you and you're kind of like, oh, like, you know, you have to be uncomfortable.
So, where are your cookies available now? Can you sell them in restaurants and that sort of thing?
We can. So there's two, the cottage law has two classes. It's class A and class B.
Oh, okay.
If you do the class B, then you can sell it in stores. So we have them at Bliss Cafe, Mama Ganache. We have them at the Shalimar Indian Restaurant. We have them at Shine in Morro Bay. We have them at Chop Street in Pismo and Steaming Bean and Seaside Cafe and Orange Cat Cafe there.
And we should mention the first three restaurants that you named are all in San Luis Obispo.
They're all in SLO.
You're San Luis Obispo County based.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Currently.
Yeah.
But you deliver, right? If
we
you're
deliver.
Close, if it's in the immediate area. And what's really cool is you're online as well for people who are not in the county.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, really? So our listeners that are up in Santa Cruz right now or the South Bay, Monterey County, they could go to your website, which is undercovercookies.com,
right.
place an order, and you'd ship them?
Yeah, that's right.
I like that.
Smart.
We featured not that long ago a gluten-free bakery up in Santa Cruz that does the same thing. We'll ship. What was it? Pele's Oven
is
the name of that
cool.
place. A gluten-free bakery that's up there.
Awesome.
Yeah. So, but they're more bread products. So what sort of flours do you have available for making cookies and that sort of thing?
Well, we use almond meal as more of the base. And then we use tapioca flour and rice flour.
Okay.
And we combine the three of them using more of the almond meal. Because when you're doing gluten-free, things can get really dense.
Yeah.
So you need to kind of mix and play with them to make them taste better.
Did you have to do a lot of experimentation, a lot of cookie batches to arrive at the right combination?
Yeah. It took a long time to come up with something that I was happy with. And I did a lot of testing and took them. I also teach yoga, so I took them to the yoga studio. And I was
cookies.
Like, everyone was testing them. So, yeah.
Where do you teach yoga? This is way off topic, but where do you?
At Bikram Yoga, right on in the Creamery.
Oh, so the hothouse style?
Yeah, that's
I cannot do that. I got to hand it to you for doing that. But I was thinking about maybe doing some smiling dog, which is not Bikram, right?
Right. It's not hot. Yeah.
Yeah. Because I really want to do that. I've been feeling all tight and stuff lately, and I thought I really need to
do a little yoga.
It's amazing.
Do a little yoga
good.
Right after I have a vegan gluten-free cookie. So I'm wondering, Valerie, and I just realized I spelled your name wrong here for people that are watching.
You pronounced it right, so that's really what's.
I spelled it Valeria. So Valeria joining us right now. Valerie, what about muffins? Are those a bigger challenge than making a cookie? Would you ever go that route?
You know, people have started to ask about brownies and muffins and bread and things like that. And it might be something that we go to down the line. But right now, we're just kind of focusing on the cookies. It's keeping us busy enough with the cookies. And we have a lot of different kinds of cookies.
You have a diverse selection. Mm-hmm. Tell us what you have and what the favorites are.
Well, we have the original chocolate chip, and that's what it started. We also have the walnut chocolate chip, and we have the double chocolate varieties, which is like chipotle double chocolate, espresso double chocolate, regular double chocolate. We have a coconut double chocolate. We also have some without chocolate because not everyone's chocolate lovers. We have lemon coconut. We have ginger molasses. We have a coconut sea salt, a caramel coconut sea salt.
Caramel and sea salt is like the huge rage.
Yes.
It definitely is a trend.
Tell us about the chocolate that you use.
We use chocolate from Mama Ganache Chocolate Shop, and it's organic and it's fair trade, and we use the 70% variety, so it's a dark chocolate and it doesn't have soy in it for people who have soy allergies, and it's delicious.
So it's healthy on yet another level.
Yeah.
Still. Again, with that stealthy healthy.
Yes. Right. We're getting it from all angles.
I would imagine if you're using almond flour, your cookies are high in protein too.
It's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know exactly what it is, the nutrition label exactly. We haven't done the testing yet, but it has a lot of almonds, so good in protein.
I like
fiber.
That aspect. Yeah. Because I, like you, have adopted a vegan lifestyle. And so now I just look at the protein levels on everything.
Right.
I don't know why I'm so obsessed with it, because really you get enough protein. Vegans do.
Yeah.
But now you need to make some cookies that are that have B12.
You know, that's a great idea.
That's
the other one,
right?
Yeah.
for that, we are speaking right now with Valerie Manzoros. She and two other people are the founders of Undercover Cookies, which is based in San Luis Obispo, all focused on food or baking cookies that are stealthy healthy. As you just heard us say, they are gluten free and also they're egg free, they're dairy free. Is it a challenge to not bake with eggs?
it takes a little bit of playing around to get a consistency that will hold up, that won't fall apart. Yeah. But it can be done. And we do use a little bit of guar gum, which holds it together. And it's natural, too. It's an Indian bean. And it kind of helps, like, stick them together. And we use the maple syrup instead of the sugar. So that helps, like, the liquid. Nice. That helps kind of keep them together, too. So it can be done. Take some time.
Valerie, you're going to need to listen to next week's show because we are having a guest on who is making these fake eggs. I don't know how else to put it. But, but it has all of the attributes of an egg, like helping baked products stick together and the texture, everything that eggs basically do. But they're not eggs and they're vegan.
Awesome.
Yeah. And so I found them. I think it was a tweet that I followed also last week, and I was like, what? Fake eggs? Hold on. You know, but they're not processed to the point where, you know, because we want to have like whole foods and,
right.
and real
foods.
Right.
We don't want the fillers and the weird stuff.
Yeah.
That we don't know what it is.
This is really groundbreaking. Once again, it's out of San Francisco, but this company that has perfected, I guess, the art of making fake eggs. So you might, I'll give you their information.
Okay,
so
great.
You might be able to incorporate that into your another line of cookies or something along those lines, right?
Awesome.
So
very cool.
9:44, the time right now. We will be back with our final segment. We'll do a little taste test in between. And let people know about the undercover cookies that no matter where you're listening to us right now, you can order these online. If you're in the Slo County area, you can pick them up at a local store. I'm your host, Randall White, joined by Patty Piper, and we're back in just a moment.
Randall White here, host of Eat, Drink, Explore Radio, with a tip for Central Coast wine tasting. Eberle Winery was recently voted Winery of the Year by the world's top sommeliers and has one of the best local tours, according to Wine Spectator. Eberle Winery opened daily 10 to 6, and the winery's cave tours and wine tasting always complimentary. It's easy to find, too. Located on Highway 46 East, just 3.5 miles from Highway 101. Now it's time to plan your visit. Just head to eberlewinery.com.
Can we have your attention for a moment? Eat, Drink, Explore Media has an important date we want to share with you. Saturday, July 13th. We invite you to join us at a craft beer and food event like no other. At Last Count, generous samples from more than 70 breweries will be paired with local culinary treats for the 2013 Breast Fest along San Francisco's waterfront at Fort Mason. Going on its 14th year, the annual Breast Fest has grown dramatically, raising money for an incredibly important cause, providing free, complimentary treatments for women battling breast cancer. The Charlotte Maxwell Clinic offers services such as acupuncture, massage, organic foods, and transportation. The clinic's core mission to provide relief from the terrible side effects of cancer and its treatments. Eat, Drink, Explore Media is very proud to be among the main sponsors for this year's event. For more information, go to thebreastfest.org.
Randall White here, host of Eat, Drink, Explore Radio, with a tip for Central Coast wine tasting. Eberle Winery was recently voted Winery of the Year by the world's top sommeliers and has one of the best local tours, according to Wine Spectator. Eberle Winery opened daily 10 to 6, and the winery's cave tours and wine tasting always complimentary. It's easy to find, too. Located on Highway 46 East, just 3.5 miles from Highway 101. Now it's time to plan your visit. Just head to eberlewinery.com.
The Eat, Drink, Explore Media radio show you are currently enjoying is in a local affiliate commercial break. Live programming will return shortly. Did you know you can watch a live video simulcast of our Sunday morning and Thursday evening shows from your computer, smartphone, or tablet device? And to top it off, it's free. Simply head to eatdrinkexplore.com. Or download our free app from the Google Play or Apple App Store. If you have a suggestion for an upcoming guest segment, send an email to radio@eatdrinkexplore.com. We're always looking for fresh ideas, including yours. We love to share fresh, local, organic, seasonal, and sustainable ideas throughout the week. And the best place to find those are on our Twitter, YouTube, and Facebook feeds. Our username across the social networking universe is simple. Eat, drink, explore, all one word. Hey, college students, Eat, Drink, Explore Media is always looking for qualified journalism or marketing interns. Send us an email today so we can check your status and put you on the list for upcoming intern vacancies. Would you like to hear this Eat, Drink, Explore radio program on one of your local radio stations? Let the station know and contact us as well so we can get the ball rolling. Okay, you made it. The local affiliate commercial break is now over. Time for more informative and entertaining programming from Eat, Drink, Explore Media. Thank you for your patience. Welcome back to the Eat, Drink, Explore Radio Network, 949, the time right now, and a very good Sunday fun day to you. This is our final segment. We have an incredibly happy crew right now in the Eat, Drink, Explore studio in downtown San Luis Obispo. We are all noshing. Nosh? Mm-hmm. That's a term, right? Yeah. The kids say it.
I'm eating chocolate chip over here.
I've got double chocolate. Our audio guy has got peanut butter. Oh, I love peanut butter cookie. And then, okay, you can have some of the chocolate too. Our guest, Valerie Manzoros, with Undercover Cookies in San Luis Obispo, brought us a wide array of the cookies that they offer that are gluten-free and vegan. And I'm wondering, Valerie, for the people who are listening right now who don't really understand this new cottage food law, can you hold on 1 second? There we go. Anthony's busy eating and looking at the audio board. So for people who don't understand this law, it passed not that long ago, and it allows people like you to make things at home. What were the first steps that you needed to go through in order to make this happen?
Well, we called the health department and we just started asking questions, and they were really helpful. Mm-hmm. And they also directed us to their website, which is pretty thorough, and it'll have a list of the requirements and what you need and what to start so that you can kind of get everything in order before they come and inspect your kitchen.
And there's a list of foods that are that are part of this. Like, you couldn't make soups at home, for instance, right?
You know, I'm not sure exactly, but there are certain restrictions of things you can. Like, I know you can't use like heavy cream because it spoils easily. So they want to have it as safe as possible, you know, because it is still going into the public. So they're narrowing the array of kind of things.
What your ingredients can be.
Yeah, so it's restricted, and I'm not sure exactly what you can and can't have, but it's listed on the website, I believe.
Basically, things that won't spoil, and the fact that you're making vegan products, I imagine, must really give you a leg up on all that.
Yeah, we didn't have to make any sort of changes. Mm-hmm. We were already kind of within the qualifications.
I don't think our kitchen would pass. I'm not really in the process.
You're not ready to start making anything that you're going to sell, but
I'm pretty sure. But I've been to a lot of my friends' homes that have beautiful kitchens, and I can imagine you must be taxing out the kitchen that you have.
It's a small kitchen. Patty knows because she was there, and it's a small oven. We actually have like the miniest oven that we just can do one tray.
It's like
at
an
a
easy
time.
Bake oven.
Yeah, slightly bigger.
Talk about quality control. You know, because they are made individually with care in this little kitchen.
Very handmade.
But still, you're cranking out some batches of cookies on your busy days. What, you told me you were at
it's
a couple hundred?
About 200 to 300 on a busy day.
Yeah.
200 to 300 batches?
No.
Cookies.
Oh,
God.
Like, oh my God.
Yeah, I wouldn't be sleeping in that case. But 200 to 300 cookies at this point. Maybe we'll work up to that.
So they always say, don't get into business with your friends. You've gotten into business with two of your friends. Mm-hmm. How's that working out?
It's pretty amazing. I mean, they're amazing and they're really patient, especially with me. And it's been going really well. Mm. And we're always having kind of meetings and figuring out how to communicate better and work things out. And we're all like big into the yoga. So I think that helps us be very zen in the
Well, I just want to say, Valerie, I don't have any diet restrictions. I eat everything. equal opportunity eater right here.
This is true. I've been to everything. Many dinner parties.
But I do really like your cookies, and I'm sure that you are not looking for that kind of compliment. That's like, well, they're good for what they are. They're good for being vegan. For me, I just ate. Sorry, you guys. I just ate a peanut butter one and a chocolate chip one. And the other day I had one of your it's not actually oatmeal, but it's your oatmeal-esque cookie.
Yeah, it's cinnamon raisin.
For people who are looking...
similar to the oatmeal raisin, yeah.
People who are looking for that fix, they're really good. Just flat, I'm just going to say this. They're just really good cookies.
Thanks.
Can you not do the oats because of gluten?
You know, there is kind of a controversy about oats, and there's... I guess you can get oats that are gluten-free, but there is a huge process and it has come from a certain facility. So I kind of didn't want to go there right away.
Yeah.
And then people were already mistaking it for having oatmeal in it. So I was like, well, they already think it has oatmeal in it and they're already happy with it. So why change it?
I'm wondering, I didn't even think about that. Is there a whole nother list of rules that you need to prove to a government agency when you put the words vegan or gluten-free on a product?
There is. And I don't know if it's completely standardized because it's kind of new, so I don't know if there's actual laws yet.
Mm-hmm.
But we are conscious and we want people who are very allergic to know, you know, what's going on,
so to feel confident in with your product,
right? And we don't use any gluten in our kitchen or any dairy for that matter, but we say that we don't use any gluten ingredients.
Mm-hmm.
So that if someone is really, really allergic and we use maybe something that is processed in a facility that does have wheat, then they know, like, okay, maybe it's not for me.
So there's no chance that there's cross-contamination in your kitchen because the ingredients just don't exist in it.
Right.
Yeah. Whereas, like, sometimes when you buy a product at any store...
it has a disclaimer that there could be some cross-contamination.
Yeah. Made in a facility that processes nuts, and it goes down a long list of things. Yeah.
Because some people with food allergies are really, really sensitive to the point of it being dangerous if they get something that has cross-contamination.
Absolutely. Right. And we're doing this to help people out. We don't want to, make it more complicated for anyone.
Yes, exactly.
I'm having Patty ask most of the questions because I can't.
You're complicating Randall's job right now because he can't talk and eat at the same time.
I can't stop shoveling the cookie into my mouth. It is so delicious. And I have to tell you, the bite that I just took, if I was at a restaurant, because I'm highly skeptical at restaurants when they say that something's vegan or something, I would turn to my fellow diners and say, there's butter in this cookie. Like I would be like, they are lying. I just took a bite that had that richness of butter. Where does that come from? This is the peanut butter cookie.
It probably comes from a combination of the peanut butter and then the olive oil that I use instead of the butter.
Yeah, olive oil. That's right.
Mm-hmm. And most people don't use olive oil because it kind of sounds weird a little bit, or maybe it sounds, I don't know. But it actually, in brownies, they say to use it because it creates like a richness. And so I tried it with the cookies and it seems to work.
I've been cooking with, I haven't bought butter in, I don't know, 20 years maybe. And I've been cooking with olive oil almost exclusively that entire time.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I'll use grapeseed oil if I really don't want an olive oil taste in something.
Right, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But it's a lot more expensive. So you already have like some of the most expensive ingredients in your cookies.
I know, we picked them. Most 10 expensive ingredients.
But yet they're not overly priced. I went to Bliss Cafe the other day and they're just $3.
They're actually $2.50.
Oh, $2.50.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So very even nice. Better.
Yeah.
I didn't have any money with me.
So you were just drooling over the...
wandering around the city and I'm like, well, I'm not going to pay for credit for, a cheap cookie. But at any rate, it was that day that it was $95.
Oh, gosh.
Friday or something.
Yeah.
So I thought, well, I can wait till Sunday when I get my sample.
Well, I have a partial peanut butter cookie here that I'm willing to negotiate with someone in this room.
We are now negotiating. Valerie Manzoros with Undercover Cookies here in San Luis Obispo. Go to undercovercookies.com for more information. Thank you so much for joining us, and thank you for bringing the cookies too.
Of course.
You did not have to do that, but
yes, she did. Yes, she did.
All right, everyone, we hope that you join us here on the Eat, Drink, Explore Radio Network next week when, like I said, we'll be speaking with someone who knows the lowdown when they've started these fake eggs. So you'll learn about the fake eggs and then, travel scams that are out there right now. You want to avoid those. Make it a great Sunday fun day. Cinco de Mayo. Get out there and enjoy yourself.
You've been listening to the Eat, Drink, Explore radio program. If you missed any of our segments today, look for them online or through our free Apple and Android apps. Catch you back right here next week.
The Eat, Drink, Explore Media radio show you are currently enjoying is in a local affiliate commercial break.